for our final panel, we're going to be discussing recent developments in private litigation in the life sciences space in the antitrust context, and how courts are dealing with some of the issues that have already been identified on the panels today. I'm Julia Chapman. I'm a member of the Antitrust Practice Group here in Philadelphia. And on my right is George Gordon, who you've met. He's a partner in, am I not on?
No, you're on. Oh. Go ahead.
Who's a partner in the Antitrust Practice Group as well. And this is Greg Bell, who's the leader of the Global Life Sciences Practice at Charles River Associates. Dr. Bell serves as both a strategic consultant as well as an expert economist in the type of antitrust life sciences cases we're going to be talking about today. And before we get started, I want to invite everyone to feel free to interrupt us with questions. Jump in. This is better if it's a discussion, and we want to be helpful to you and answer questions that you have. So, George, to start us off, what are the key issues that courts have been grappling with in pharmaceutical antitrust cases? And do those issues differ depending on the type of conduct that's being challenged?
Thank you, Julia. One point to make, and we've talked about some of the issues already related to the type of conduct, but private cases raise issues that don't come up in government investigation context, right? They raise issues related to causation, that is whether or not the conduct actually caused injury to the antitrust plaintiffs. They raise issues related to damages, how you model and calculate damages, and they raise issues regarding procedural vehicles like class actions, class certification, that are not relevant in the government sphere. So, you know, some of the and those issues can differ. I mean, there's some commonality in that in these cases, the causation, the harm to competition issues tend to dominate, but how they manifest in each of these cases can be very different. One of the and each of these cases raises obviously a host of unique issues based on individual facts of the case. But some of the examples of the issues that come up in these cases include the role of the patent and the exclusionary effect of the patent in assessing causation, for example, in a reverse payment case. If the case settled, but if the case hadn't settled, the branded company would have won the patent case and kept the generic out for longer. Is there any harm from the settlement? And how do you bake that into the antitrust analysis of the settlement agreement? Other theories, other alternative theories of causation that are pursued by plaintiffs in these cases to try to sidestep that issue include, well, if the party still would have settled this case, but they would have said if it weren't for the payments, they would have settled with an earlier entry date. We talked a little bit on the last panel about this issue in product hopping related to what is the role of the fact that the generic can still compete with the new version of the pharmacy of the branded product, right? It's not exclusionary. Product hopping is not exclusionary in the sense that it prevents the generic from entering at a particular period of time, like allegedly a patent settlement might. And the generic is still free to compete, although it has to do so in a different way. How does that get taken into account in analyzing harm and both the competition and individual plaintiffs? And also the issues of, you know, what are the reasons if there has been a product hop, old products been pulled or other actions have been taken, why? You know, is there a legitimate justification for those? So those are some of the issues we'll dive into that courts have been grappling with and which has been some interesting decisions.
And so, Greg, from your perspective, what are the key economic issues that come up in those cases?
Well, I think, you know, one of the things that has been talked about today is all of this is so fact specific. That's kind of the number one thing that crops up from my perspective. The second one is always another thing we heard about today. Think about or have a perspective on what was the underlying business purpose, notwithstanding the exclusionary conduct. What else was going on from the business perspective? I think a third thing, you know, we hear a lot about competition and protecting competition. Again, particularly in the first panel, we heard a lot about this idea of nascent competition. I like to talk about it as the difference between static competition and dynamic competition. And in the pharmaceutical industry, I would hope a number of people would agree that the biggest advances have come as a result of aggressive dynamic competition. A lot, I would suggest, of the, you know, private litigation cases really focus on static competition. And I wonder oftentimes the extent to which, you know, incentives are being confused and arguably lost, you know, and we end up with pejorative terms like product hopping. I would like to suggest it's new and improved, but it's the same kind of issues. And I think there are aspects where there's conduct, which in some cases folks would agree it would appear to be egregious. And in other cases, the exact same conduct is in fact, you know, welfare maximizing. For instance, pulling red product registrations for opioids that were not abuse deterring formulations. Many would argue that's actually welfare maximizing, and not a problem for competition.
I certainly would.
So, to move on, I want to take the key issues that both of you have identified and get into how they're actually playing out in the cases that are in front of the courts. And so starting with reverse payment cases, which you'd mentioned, George, how are courts answering the question of whether you should or whether you even can look at and consider the outcome of that underlying patent litigation?
So one thing that was really interesting about activists and watching how lower courts have applied it, which I think has lessons for those of us who practice in the antitrust world for the development of the antitrust rule of reason outside of the area of patent settlements and certainly even outside of the area of life sciences, is that the court and activists gave the lower courts a lot of discretion in figuring out how to structure the antitrust analysis to meet the facts of the case. The court basically said, "Hey, you don't normally have to look into the validity of the patent," but they didn't say you never did. They said you should apply the antitrust rule of reasons. These things aren't going to be presumptively unlawful, but we're going to let you figure out how to apply the rule of reason given all the complexities of the case. And one area where I think the thinking that has gone into the cases is going to have a lasting effect on antitrust and particularly on antitrust cases involving IP, it is the role of the patent. I think a lot of the thinking and the kind of the shifting of thinking of patents as a bundle of rights to really being, you know, a right to exclude, to really being kind of a probabilistic right to enforce, right? Which is kind of what the whole reverse payment theory is based on, that you don't necessarily have a right to exclude someone when you have your patent. What you do is you have a right to enforce it, and whether you're going to win that case, you don't know. I think that's eroded to a certain extent some of the respect that has been given to patents. For those of you who are kind of students of antitrust history, I don't know that we're back to the days of the Justice Department had the nine no-nos. You know, there were kind of nine things you just couldn't do with your patent. That was probably the low watermark of respect given to patent rights in antitrust cases. I don't think we're quite there, but there's certainly been an erosion of that. And you've seen that in the cases that they've struggled with how to try to give some life in the private cases. Where courts have recognized, like, we got to deal with this patent issue because private plaintiffs have to show causation in a way that the FTC does not in their cases under Section 5 of the FTC Act. So how do we give some life to it? Do we, you know, for example, have a presumption of validity and push the burden onto the antitrust plaintiffs to overcome that, or vice versa? And what's the level of proof? How do we ask a jury in an antitrust case to decide what a judge would have done, because the patent cases are going to be bench trials, because they're Hatch-Waxman cases are bench trials. How do we ask a jury to decide what a judge would have done in the patent case? So a lot of complexities. And if you look at the cases, they're really on a spectrum, right? Because courts, the lower courts, are still trying to figure this out. I think the Wellbutrin case here in which Judge McLaughlin, one of our former partners, working with Julia, who was clerking for her at the time, issued a decision in the Wellbutrin case that really, I think, you know, a large part of the, and that case involves some unique facts, but a large part of the decision to grant summary judgment in favor of the defendants had to do with the exclusionary effect of the patent and the recognition that if the generics would have been excluded by the patent, then there really can't be any antitrust harm. On the other side of the spectrum, you have Judge Thrash and Androgel, who about, I guess, a year ago, you know, borrowing a phrase from someone else, I can't remember who which judge originally used the phrase, but he called the whole problem a turducken, right? I don't know how many people are familiar with turducken, right? It's a duck inside the turkey. And he said, look, you've got to, what the parties want me to do is try a patent case in an antitrust case about the settlement of the patent case. And he said, I'm not going to do it. You know, it raises just too many of those uncertainties that I talked about before. Neither party can rely on a theory that is based on the outcome of the underlying patent case. So defense can't argue that the brand company would have won the patent case, and the plaintiffs can't argue that the generic company would have entered at risk, because that, for a variety of reasons, also requires proof related to whether or not the entry at risk would have been unlawful. And then you've got courts in between. You've got the courts in Judge Orrick in the Lidoderm case. You've got the Solidin case that have basically tried to kind of balance it, but it put a very low burden on the plaintiffs. They said the plaintiffs carry their burden by, if they just come forward with some evidence, or they either come forward, I think the words in Solidin were, some evidence that the generic, if the case hadn't settled, would have won the patent case. And Judge Orrick said, well, if the generic show that the, if the antitrust plaintiffs show that the generic could have won the patent case, which if you think about it, so if it's a patent case that has survived summary judgment, it's a pretty darn low standard, right? Because if a case has survived summary judgment and you're still heading to trial, then that's really kind of recognition that either side could have won that case. And, you know, I think from my perspective, the courts are still trying to figure this out. I think it's, frankly, intellectually dishonest to ignore this issue. I don't think you can get away from it, because it is a fact that, you know, if the antitrust defendant, the branded company, had won the patent case, if it did have sufficiently strong intellectual property, then there would have been no harm to consumers, because generics would have been kept out for longer.
And so I think that the tension that you've identified, and the fact that some courts, like the Androgel court, just wants to throw up his hands and say, I can't touch this, it's just inherently too speculative, is why you've seen plaintiffs turning to alternative theories of causation in these cases. And what are those theories? How are those theories taking shape? What do they look like?
So the principal theory, alternative theory of causation the plaintiffs are using, is this alternative settlement theory. That is, they say we don't have to deal with it. Even if they're arguing a theory based on the outcome of the patent case, they say, even if we're wrong about that, we don't really have to deal with that, because what would have happened is there's just an exchange of value in the settlement. So if you took some of that value out, whether it was in the old days, a cash payment or some other value that was given over to the generic, the parties could have made up that value in the settlement agreement by giving the generic an earlier entry date, so that you would have a settlement, a no payment settlement, with an earlier entry date. And therefore you would have had, you know, earlier generic competition. They model this slightly different ways, but they bring in economic experts to model how that negotiation would have come out. And they basically try to model kind of the latest date that the generic company would have settled for that would have made it kind of as well off as challenging the patent. And they look at the earliest date that the branded company would have agreed to settle for that would have made it just as well off as continuing the patent litigation. And if that earlier date is before the later date of the generic, they say that's where the settlement negotiations would have ended up because both parties would have had an interest to settle in that range of dates. And it's if it's before the date of the actual settlement agreement, then the settlement agreement was anti-competitive. Now, the thing is, this happens in cases with zero evidence, right, that any of this actually would have happened. So you're kind of trying to look into a crystal ball backwards about how the settlement agreements would have come out. And I have to say, I think it is the high watermark for the use of economic modeling to support kind of utter speculation.
Well, I wonder if I could just
you can respond
comment on that. I've got nothing against some economists in courts engaging in quote unquote utter speculation. But I will say one of the fundamental difficulties with some of these alternative settlement proposals is it's sort of the same problem of the economist is stuck in the desert and trying to figure out, well, what are they going to do? And of course, the first thing is, well, assume I've got a supply of water. And a lot of these alternative settlements assume that there's some agreement about the likelihood of winning the case. A lot of the plaintiffs' economists go to some great lengths to try and hide the fact that at the very base of some of these alternative settlement theories, they do have this assumption that there's a shared expectation of what the likelihood of victory was going to be in the case. And I would suggest, one of the main reasons why we have a lot of these cases is because there isn't that shared assumption. Plaintiffs tend to, lots of work has been done on this, assume a greater likelihood that they're going to win, and defendants assume a greater likelihood that they're going to win. And one of the major reasons why you see cash or other means of value potentially exchanged in patent settlement agreements is to bridge some of those differences in expectations as opposed to the cost and the turmoil of going to litigation. So I agree completely around a lot of this stuff about the alternate settlement theories, this idea that somehow you can take the value out of the settlement and just decide, oh, it would have been an earlier entry date. I think is starting from a premise that simply or may not have existed. And this is this issue again. You need to keep coming back to the facts of that particular situation. And I think I'd like to just add one more thing on that. There's been all kinds of strum and drang about what does large mean in all of this context. And I think that that's actually a very fair characterization. What's large in a patent settlement litigation with respect to a drug that's selling $5 billion a year is a different number than what's large in a patent settlement agreement for a drug that's selling $100 million a year. And that, too, is something that needs to be considered when we're looking at some of these issues.
Yeah. And in defense of the plaintiffs' economists, I will have to say, and in full disclosure, the courts have been receptive to the alternative settlement theory, at least at the summary judgment stage. I mean, the Leida-Durham court, mm-hmm. the Saladin court, the Androgel court, they have not thrown experts out on Daubert challenges for that theory, and they have allowed cases to proceed past summary judgment on that theory. So it's and again, it depends on the individual facts of the cases, right. But it's a theory that has gained traction.
And so just a quick follow-up question. If a court at the summary judgment stage is trying to answer the question, would the parties have reached an alternative settlement, because that's the standard at least set forth mm-hmm. by some courts, what should they be looking at to answer that?
Well, not being a lawyer, I think the key mm-hmm. really is the fact-specific circumstances. And I guess by definition, that means it has to go past summary judgment.
Right. But, well, I think it depends. I think one source of evidence about what might have happened is the negotiating history over the settlement.
Oh, sure. Okay.
Right? Is there any evidence that there was any trading going on? And it doesn't have to be explicit. Any trading of the date of entry for some other value? You know, in the kind of stylized example, you know, we'll enter in January of 2020 instead of January 2019 if you branded company give us X, right? If you have that type of, or something that's at least allows an inference of that, that those are facts, right?
Right. It's based in the record. And so I want to stick with the question of causation and competitive effects, but move to the product hopping cases. I'm not going to use your new term. Have courts considered in the product hop context, generics' ability to compete with the new version of the product, something that's relevant to the competitive effects analysis?
All right. So, and this is, you know, to kind of piggyback on the point that Melanie made in our last panel, it is, I agree that it's a troubling theory because there's no other industry in which a competitor is required to take some step to maintain the market for its rivals. I mean, if you were innovating in, refrigerators, and you came up with a new brand new refrigerator, no one's going to suggest you have to keep selling and marketing your old refrigerator just to maintain a market for your rivals. And there's a longstanding antitrust principle that you don't have that. Including reflected in the Aspen skiing case that was mentioned on the last panel. But on the other side, the proponents of the product hopping theory say, but pharmaceutical industry isn't like any other industry, right? And the and Congress and state legislators have decided that there are certain circumstances and conditions that should affect the way generics have to compete. And that's kind of the philosophical battle. Now, how that's actually played out in cases is, you know, courts again are have differed on it, right? You've got the Namenda case from Southern District of New York and the Second Circuit, which involved Forrest's alleged product hop with Alzheimer's drug Namenda, in which the courts really sided more with the proponents of the theory and said, look, By engaging in this type of innovation and pulling the old product off, you're depriving the generic entrants of the ability to take advantage of automatic drug substitution. And automatic drug substitution is kind of a feature of competition baked into the competitive landscape by law. And you're interfering with that, and you're raising a barrier to entry that Congress and state legislators have tried to eliminate. And so didn't really, you know... give much weight to the idea that generics still can compete. By contrast, there's a case involving Dorix here in the Eastern District of Pennsylvania, went up to the Third Circuit, where in granting summary judgment for the defendants on, among other things, harm to competition, Judge Diamond took very seriously the fact that Mylan, who was the generic in that case, did have the ability to keep competing, even though there were these multiple kind of, quote, product hops on Dorix, did have the ability to compete, looked at the data, looked at how successful Mylan had been in penetrating the market, how much it had been able to earn, and said, you know, that's just competition. That's the way competition is supposed to happen. And yes, Mylan had to do things it wasn't expecting it had to do, but that's what we expect from competitors in the marketplace. Now, there are different issues in each case or different facts. He did make a Judge Dye made a big deal about the fact that the branded in that case was, I forget how many times, smaller than Mylan, and Mylan had sufficient resources to compete. The jury's still out, so to speak, on kind of what role the generic's ability to compete will play in these product hopping cases.
I guess, and in the previous panel, the Suboxone point came up. You know, certainly the issue of taking product listing off such that by definition, a generic hasn't got anything to reference to. Fair enough. I can certainly see that's problematic, and there may be other reasons why it's appropriate to remove a listing, like safety reasons and the like. But I mean, if the generic can launch, and that hasn't been interfered with, the generic has got its major card to play, which it's two cards. One is price. And the second one is the fact that there have been several years where this product has been on the market safe and efficacious. And in the U.S., with the formularies and the like that are available, generic goes on tier one. Some of the more aggressive payers, you know, you could imagine a Kaiser Permanente or something like that says, you know what, you got to fail on the generic before we're going to pay for the prescription on the brand, which, oh, by the way, is going to be on tier three and a heck of a lot more expensive. So it's not entirely clear to me at all how some of these sequential innovation products end up somehow interfering with the generics' ability to compete. Again, almost but for taking the listing off so that they've lost the ability to reference, their ability to compete, their, you know, the opportunity to engage in automatic substitution simply hasn't been impacted.
Did you want to add something? Okay.
Just one more point on product, Adriana, yeah. If you're moving off of that. I think the practical takeaway, and I think this is kind of discussed, the details of this that was discussed in the last panel, but just to kind of just bring it up to a general takeaway point. If you're considering launching a new product and you're, you know, the real issue in these cases is what you do with the old one, right? And if you're, if it's really not, I mean, a lot of clients, I think, when they're coming to this issue the first time, focus on all the evidence that the new product is an advantage, right? And it's not really just about whether the new product is better. It's what you do with the old one and why. Sure. And you really need to make sure you have a very clear record. If you think there's a reasonable basis to remove that product from the market, either for safety reasons or otherwise, you need to make sure you have you have that well documented, and that it's going to be subject to scrutiny. I mean, that it's going to stand up to scrutiny, right? It's not going to look like a, no one's going to be able to second guess you. If the science supports it, you need to make sure that the evidence is clear and it's well documented, because you may have to make that case someday, either in private litigation or to government enforcers.
So I wanted to move on to another type of conduct that gets challenged, and I think has been challenged more recently, and that's rebating, where, and this is oversimplifying it, but to some extent it's a challenge that, you know, you charged me too little. And I'm curious how the competitive harm and the damages issues in rebating cases differ from some of the other types of conduct that we're dealing with.
I definitely think there's a challenge there on competitive harm with the so-called rebate trap, where the idea here might be, for example, in a biosimilar, it is too expensive for the payer to move away from the branded product and shift to the biosimilar, because as a result of doing that, they may lose a lot of rebates. But, you know, one of the major tenets of competition is, in fact, price competition. The rebating is certainly a form of price competition. I think we could all come up with, you know, rebate type agreements that folks would say those are approaching the line or maybe even egregious. But the challenge of calculating damages in a situation where you're going to end up paying more for both products strikes me as really a fairly significant concern.
I agree. Yeah, I think, I mean, and I think from a conceptual standpoint, I mean, rebating and discounting cases, present a challenge because they also run counter to, the idea that antitrust law encourages lower prices and price competition. So distinguishing those cases where the effect of the rebate to kind of draw sales to the alleged antitrust violator is because it's just, there's situations where it's just because it's a good deal and that's what's attracting the sales versus some coercive effect from the rebate mm-hmm. so that customers are making a decision that they wouldn't otherwise make is very difficult. And courts have split on it. I mean, there's not uniformity among the circuits in terms of how you define and distinguish perfectly appropriate rebating or bundling of rebates from those that might be potentially anti-competitive.
And I do think this is one of those cases where it's protecting the competitor rather than protecting competition.
Right. And so all of the types of conduct that we've been discussing so far are going to be analyzed under the rule of reason. First question in that analysis is, does the defendant have market power? Has there been any traction to challenges to market definition beyond just the single molecule, single product market?
I mean, I think the only successful challenge at the summary judgment stage, so, as a matter of law, where a defendant actually got, in one of these cases, summary judgment in its favor of market definition, is in the Dorix case. It was the other grounds on which Judge Diamond ruled in favor of the defendants. In almost every other case, either there have been cases, Judge Orrick and Leiterdurm actually gave summary judgment to the plaintiffs on market definition. In most of the other cases, the judges have just said, look, it's too fact specific. Another concerning thing that, and the plaintiffs argue this, and it hasn't been it was picked up on an Androgel, is that there's a suggestion that if you have a large and unexplained payment in a reverse payment case, that you can infer market power from the size of the payment, which would then allow you to skip market definition. Right? The plaintiffs are always looking in these cases for direct evidence of market power because market definition is really kind of a step that you need to take if you're inferring market power from circumstantial evidence. They always look for ways to try to skip that step, looking at like margins, looking at the size of the unexplained payment. Those haven't really gotten a lot of traction, except in Androgel, Judge Thrash did say, look, they can infer market power from the size of the payment. If they can convince a jury that it was a large and unexplained payment, you can infer market power from that.
Yeah, I think the question of market definition in pharma is going to get a lot tougher as we go forward because of the big molecules, the biologics that are actually useful in a wide variety of indications. In indications that are not equally overlapping. And so that this issue of what's the market for, a product like, say, Remicade, well, it's kind of got three, rheumatoid arthritis, the GI issues, and derm. And one of its major competitors, Enbrel, only, got passed muster in clinical trials on two of those. And then you got biosimilars that may come to the market and only have to show in one of them and then get the benefit of indication expansion. So I think market definition is going to become more difficult because of the clinical aspects of these products. And then it's always been problematic from the price issue, right? And there's, again, from the strategy side, I do a lot of work. We do a lot of work on how you compete for formulary position. And that's a payer by payer by payer competition. It's got virtually nothing to do with list price. It's all about the net price, and the net prices are not public. Some of these decisions on market definition because somebody hasn't shown
cross price elasticity of demand, well, it's a little difficult to show it if you don't know what any of the prices are. So I think in the pharmaceutical industry, there does need to be more consideration of reasonable substitutes in use. You know, look at formularies, look at the clinical guidelines, look at how physicians are prescribing and using products. I think that just becomes more important, and it's going to be even more important as we go forward.
I want to move on to class certification. George, what arguments, if any, have been successful recently in challenging class certification, perhaps starting with end payers and then separately addressing the direct purchaser classes?
So I'll talk a little bit about just kind of the legal landscape, and then, you know, Greg can talk about kind of the economic modeling of all these things. So typically you have two classes, two groups of class in these cases. End payers are the third party payers and consumers, sometimes in the same class, sometimes not in the same class. And direct purchasers are typically the wholesalers, those who purchase directly from the alleged antitrust violators. On the end payer side, and the end payer side, you know, by and large, the plaintiffs have been very successful in getting classes certified in these cases generally. To the extent there's been any pushback on that, it's really largely come on the end payer side. And really where most of the action has been lately is on issues related to the ability to kind of identify uninjured class members. So to step back for a second, the issue on class certification often in these cases centers on whether or not common issues predominate in the case. And common issues are issues that can be proven using proof that's common across the class. So it's not individualized to each individual class member. One of the issues that has come up in predominance is whether or not you can prove impact. One of the issues focused on is whether you can prove impact, that is fact of injury, not level of injury, fact of injury to class members using common proof. In these pharma cases, there are often groups of end payers who won't be injured by the alleged increase in price caused by the exclusionary conduct. So they could be brand loyalists, right? These are like in a reverse payment case where the idea is that you delayed the launch of a generic. If a class member would not have bought the generic anyway, they're not injured. There could be people who, by virtue of their health plan design, there wouldn't have been a difference in the price they paid for a variety of different reasons that Greg can probably speak to in more detail as a matter of economics. And there have been a few different cases recently where courts have said, look, there are a substantial number of uninjured class members that the defendants have identified exist, and the plaintiffs haven't provided any methodology for identifying who they are using common proof, because there's no way of, without getting into the details of what your health plan looked like, you know, what's going to happen, what would have happened if there had been a generic earlier, how that would have affected your copay, for example. There's no way of identifying them using common proof, so they have actually refused to certify classes. Happened recently in the Thalamid case. It happened in the Askol case up in the First Circuit. But there's a split among the circuits. This is an issue that's hotly debated as to kind of how many uninjured class members, how big a percentage of the class this has to be. Is it enough? Is it enough if it's 5% of the class? Does it have to be 10% of the class? I think most circuits would recognize if you have some substantial percentage of the class that's uninjured, it's probably going to defeat class certification. But there's really no uniformity about the size. And on the direct purchaser side, they're even harder to oppose. A few cases recently have focused on the numerosity issue, numerosity being just the number of class members. There tend to be fewer of them on the direct purchaser side. Again, depends on the case, and it depends who the plaintiffs try to include in their class. If you've got a class somewhere in the 20 to 30 range on the existing case law, you've probably got a good argument that those class members could, particularly because some of them, I mean, typically the top three wholesalers tend to make up about, you know, 80 to 90% of the purchases, depending on the drug. So when you've got you know, you've got large purchasers who have incentive to bring cases on their own, and it's easy for others to join them outside of a class context. You have a pretty good argument. Once you start getting above like 35 to 40, it's a little less clear. And above 40, it's class members, it's presumptive. You've presumptively satisfied numerosity. But that's really where the battleground has been in the direct purchaser cases.
And so, Greg, getting to the kind of questions of common proof from an economic perspective.
Yeah, I don't have a ton on the direct purchasers. I think on the end payers, George really did hit the nail on the head. There are a number of different segments of consumers that, depending on the facts, the circumstances, their own individual circumstances, and the therapeutic category that might be at issue, whether or not they're going to be significant chunks that are, in fact, uninjured. We've got the couponing programs that are out there and pay no more than $5 for a brand. Not going to be a lot of end payer injury there. High deductible health plans, more and more and more of those out there. And if you're for some of these high cost therapies, you're going to blast through the deductible anyway. So you've got issues of what are the other comorbid conditions that some of these patients may have. You've got what's the different treatments of brands and generics in the coverage gap in Medicare Part D. You've got what happens if you go past your ceiling of coverage. So as we're seeing more and more proliferation, that might be repetitious, but as we're seeing proliferation of insurance plans and the like and insurance plan designs, we're going to find more and more segments of customers that in fact may not have been injured. And I think this is going to be an increasing challenge for folks to actually show through common proof impact on a set of ostensible class members.
So before we open it up to questions, I want to pose the question to both of you. What litigation issues do you see on the horizon for the life sciences industry? And I know in particular, George, the kind of unprecedented generic drug litigation that's pending here in Philly.
Yeah, so there are two issues I would point to that we haven't talked about already today. One is the generic drugs price fixing litigation. And really the aspect of that litigation where the state AGs and the private plaintiffs have alleged overarching conspiracies, and these are and so there are got well over 125 drugs at issue in these cases, and the majority of the defendants in the case manufacture fewer than five of the drugs at issue, yet all of the defendants are alleged to have participated in an overarching conspiracy to fix the price of all of the drugs. So it raises some probably obvious issues with respect to the kind of proof that's going to be required, that the theory has survived motion to dismiss. But I think an interesting issue is going to be how the court's going to deal and how the plaintiffs are going to demonstrate at summary judgment, come forward with sufficient proof to demonstrate that, if I don't make, 120 of 125 different drugs, why would I possibly care about the pricing? Absent evidence of, market allocation where I've agreed, right, not to enter those markets, but absent that, how all of these defendants can be tied together into a conspiracy where there's really no evidence that any of them actually kind of knew of this supposed totally overarching conspiracy, let alone knowingly committed to enter it. So I think that's one. I think the other, issue that's popping up again, it's come up in a couple cases, like the Humira case, is the patent thicket idea, that the idea that you can just have too many patents. I think as a legal matter, it matters how you got the patents. I mean, there are different legal theories depending on whether they're kind of homegrown, internally generated patents versus acquired patents. Some patents you acquire are subject to the same laws as, you know, any other acquisition of an asset. And I think some of the thinking I talked about earlier about kind of the diminution in respect that's being given to patents may come out to play in those cases. But the patent thicket idea has over time kind of popped up in different industries. It's never really gotten a lot of traction outside of the acquisition of a bunch of patents. If you go out and acquire a bunch of your competitors' patents in order to build a wall around your product, that raises a host of different issues, at least as a legal matter. I don't know about as a matter of economics, but as a legal matter, it raises a whole host of different issues than if you have simply kind of innovated and actually applied for and obtained your own patents.
Again, I think a lot of this just keeps coming back to the facts that are specific to these circumstances. You know, as a general matter, I think we all can probably appreciate it is exceptionally difficult to manage some overarching conspiracy as you increase the number of competitors and as you increase the number of products and the amount of the differentiation of the products. I mean, this thing goes up exponentially in terms of difficulty. Patent thicket, ton of work that's happened in years past on in economics around, you know, the competitive effects of patents. A lot of this was initially driven in the technology industries. In addition to George's points about, you know, how you acquire them, I think the extent to which you may or may not be practicing can be an issue for the potential anti-competitive impact of acquiring a lot of patents. And I would like to add a third one. You know, it is something we heard in the second panel about the excessive pricing or the fair pricing. You know, another California laws come out around the rationale for price increases. I guess it is something that as a within the life sciences practice at CRA, we're actually doing some work because I think it's unfortunately, with all due respect, I don't think it's terribly compelling to say, well, I'll know it when I see it if it's unfair. We've got to be able to do something better than that, because this issue of what's fair, you know, sure, it's a legal issue, but it's also, you know, the front page issue for the Wall Street Journal and the like when it comes to the pharma industry. And there needs to be a push towards trying to frame that debate in hopefully what can be a reasonable manner from both the consumers, competitors, and innovators' perspective.
With that, we'll open it up for questions.
Looks like it.
So the very last comment on the break.
Thank you very much. Just on your very last comment, I'm always in trouble because I tend to always agree with Rafael. I agree with you, but then the conclusions you draw, I have a problem. So I need to qualify. When I said I know it when I see it, I think that's the first step. So when you say the end is very difficult to calibrate, how much is the excessive? What will be the remedy, the proper price? The mere fact that it's extremely difficult or maybe will not be sufficiently scientific probably doesn't negate the first question when you see Shkreli at all, to say that I know it when I see it, so I have to start to work on it. Because it's the same with obscenity for Justice Stewart's point that the court was compelled to draw somewhere a line on a continuum of shades of grays, whether you express these shades of grays on EBITDA or whatever way and form. So the first thing is to get over the philosophical argument that the invisible hand and everything is fine, the market will take care of it. Right. So then comes in another layer, which I didn't want to undermine the type of things, and we are working on it. I cannot speak about it within the commission, whatever we can add to this discussion to introduce something more than I know it when I see it, because clearly the outcome is not enough to declare the 7,500 price increase based on the same economic circumstances illegal or excessive, mm-hmm. and you stop there. You need to give de facto de jure guidance what companies should think should be the ballpark where they go. And that's where we would rely on the economics professions contribution.
Yeah, I think that's fair. I think that this question is going to get much bigger than the generics. I think it is going to be something that is going to enter into a more of the public debate around the $1 million therapies and the $1 million cures. And a number of in other countries, they've got the regulations around launch pricing and then the regulations around increases in pricing. So for instance, in Canada, you can end up in this paradoxical circumstance where your launch price is fine, your increase is ruled inappropriate, even though your ending price is less than the others that are on the marketplace. So I just think this whole issue around pricing in pharmaceuticals, it's got, as I say, the legal issues, it's got public policy issues, and it is something that we need to do a better job generating a frame of reference for, because otherwise we're always going to be in this issue of everybody's going to say ex post, yeah, that's too high.
Okay, I think everyone's probably hungry. We do have lunch, so invite everybody to grab lunch and come back and stay a while. So thank you everyone for attending.